We've already discussed the relationship between the location of a point in the scene and the blur circle it produces in the image. But what we haven't discussed is the distribution of light within the blur circle, which is called the point spread function. So first, let's review some of the concepts we have discussed thus far. We'll start with the Gaussian lens law. We know how the Gaussian lens law works. You have a lens with some aperture of diameter d, and let's assume that this is your object right here, and it's at a distance O from the lens. So light from this object is refracted or bent by the lens to be focused at this point behind the lens, which is at a distance I from the lens. So this distance, is this plane on which the image is formed, is what we'll call the image plane. And we know that O and I are related to one another through the focal length or the bending power of the lens. And we have 1 over F is equal to 1 over I plus 1 over O. So that's the Gaussian lens law. So now let's take a look at what happens when the image sensor does not lie on the image plane. So the image sensor now lies at a distance from the image plane, and you of course end up getting a blur circle. Just want to quickly mention why this is a circle. Irrespective of where this focus point lies on this plane, what you always have is a cone subtended with respect to the aperture. The aperture we are assuming is a circle. And so it's a cone, and the base of the cone is a circle, and that cone is being intersected by this plane on which the image sensor sits. And if that plane is parallel to the lens plane, then this is always going to be a circle. It's going to have the same shape as the aperture itself. And the size, of course, depends on the distance of the image sensor from the image plane. And that distance of the image sensor from the lens is called S right here. So now we can say that the diameter of your blur circle B divided by D is equal to I minus S, which is a shift with respect to the plane of focus, divided by I right here. So you get an expression for the diameter of the blur circle. And you can see here that if you now move S further, if you move the image sensor further away from the plane of focus, that means that S is going to get smaller in this case. So therefore, S divided by I is going to get smaller, and as a result, your blur is going to get larger. And that's exactly what happens. If you move the image sensor here, you get a larger blur circle. And there's another way to change the blur in the image, and that is by changing the size of the aperture itself. You can see that B is proportional to D, and therefore if you stop down the aperture, you lower the diameter of the aperture, you do this, then you're going to get a smaller blur circle right here. So all this to say that there are two ways in which you can control the blur of a point in the image. One is by moving the image sensor, and the other is by stopping down the aperture of the lens. Okay, so that brings us to the point spread function. We know what the shape of this function is. It's going to be a circle, it's going to be a disk, but now what we're interested in knowing is how is light distributed within that disk, and that's the point spread function. It is the response of a camera system to a point source or an impulse. We discussed this before. It's also called the impulse response. Okay, so if you take the simplest model possible, one can argue that the light within the blur circle is going to be uniformly distributed. Well, if that's the case, you get a very simple function, which is called the pillbox function, which essentially has a circular shape, that's the boundary, and it has a constant value inside. And that value is 4 divided by pi b squared, where once again b is the diameter of the blur circle. And this constant essentially changes with the size of the blur circle so as to ensure that the amount of light that falls within the blur circle is equal to the amount of light received by the lens from the point. It's conservation of energy. So that's your pillbox function. Now, in reality, you almost never get a pillbox function. And that's because in practice, you have many other things at work here. You have, as we discussed before, the diffraction effect that happens at the aperture itself. The aperture is an opening. At the edge of the aperture, you're going to have bending of light, and that's diffraction. So that's one effect. And then you have a variety of lens aberrations. This could be chromatic aberrations, geometric aberrations, and you have lens imperfections as well. Those effects also ensure that the distribution of light within the blur circle is not going to be constant. It's going to vary. And then on top of that, you have image sensing. You have pixelation or pixels that are gathering light within some area. That's the active area of each pixel. So you can view the effect of that as the optical image falling on the sensor plane. And then you have the pixel, the shape of the pixel being convolved with that optical image. And then that then is sampled at discrete points. So all of those effects together almost guarantee that you're not going to get a pillbox function, but you end up getting something that looks more like a Gaussian. It has a strong value in the center and then falls off. So very often for these kind of problems, these kind of techniques, the point spread function is assumed to be a Gaussian. And we know how the Gaussian works. It has a peak at the center, and it also has a normalization constant outside, which once again guarantees that the amount of light that's received by the lens from the point is equal to the light that falls within the blur circle. And as a rule of thumb, if you want to relate the sigma of your Gaussian to the diameter of the blur circle that we've been discussing thus far, we can say sigma is roughly equal to b divided by 2, b being the diameter of the blur circle in our previous model. Okay, so that's the point spread function. Now let's take a look at how this point spread function manifests in the case of defocus or blur. So let's assume for a moment that we have a patch in the scene with constant depth. And then in that case, so that's this patch right here. Let's say it has constant depth. And let's say that this is what the patch looks like when it is not blurred, when it is perfectly in focus. So essentially what's going on here is because the depth is constant, the point spread function is being convolved, or this focused image is being convolved with the point spread function. And that's because defocus, we know, for constant depth at least, is linear and it's shift invariant. And therefore you end up, and we know that any linear shift invariant system is really performing a convolution. So really this focused image convolved with the point spread function corresponding to that depth, we've assumed depth to be constant, ends up giving you the captured image or your blurred image right here. So in reality, when you have a surface that is curved, that is changing in terms of its depth everywhere, this doesn't really apply because the convolution only applies if the depth is constant, because otherwise your point spread function is actually changing from pixel to pixel, which makes it not a linear shift invariant system. But for practical purposes here, what we can say is that we can take our scene and divide it up into small regions and essentially assume that the depth within each one of those regions is constant, and therefore the convolution model applies to each patch in the scene. And that's why we're able to use this model. Okay, so what we have here is that defocus can be expressed as convolution. It's a focused image convolved with the point spread function, which gives you the captured image right here. And now we can take a look at what this means in frequency domain or Fourier domain. Let's assume that this is the Fourier transform FUV, FO, O for the original focused image, UV, and that's what you're looking at. Of course, we're looking at one slice here, It's actually a two-dimensional function, but one slice. And we're also looking at the magnitude here. And so since the focus is convolution in spatial domain, we know that it's multiplication in Fourier domain. So you have this Fourier transform of the focused image multiplied with the Fourier transform of your point spread function. Now, if the point spread function is a Gaussian, we know the Fourier transform of a Gaussian is a Gaussian, and that's why this is a Gaussian right here. As the point spread function gets narrower and narrower, that means the image gets more and more focused, so to speak, less blurring, its Fourier transform is going to get broader and broader, and therefore it actually passes in, allows more high frequencies to go through. So you have the Fourier transform of the focused image multiplied by this Gaussian gives you the Fourier transform of the captured image. And we can see here that the more defocused the image gets, which means as the point spread function gets broader, you're going to have a narrower Gaussian in Fourier domain, and therefore you're going to have less high frequencies being passed in. So in other words, you can say that defocus, the whole process of defocus, is really low pass filtering. It just allows the low frequencies in the original image to pass through, but it's severely attenuating the high frequencies. Therefore, this gives us a bit of a hint in that if we wanted to recover depth information from defocus, we should be paying attention to the high frequencies in the image and processing the high frequencies and ignoring the low frequencies.